listening to The Bottom Line with Larry Arnett. Larry will take your phone calls at 749-1444. And now, here's Larry.
Okay, welcome to another edition of The Bottom Line. This is Larry Arnett coming to you as I do every Thursday, 5 until 6 p.m. right here on WAIF 88.3 FM. And we got a lot of guests in the studio today, so we want to get on with the show. I wasn't here last week. Thanks to Roger for subbing for me. And I'll get into my exploits out on the west, out on the west where I was. And I got a gun that's pretty cool here, but I can't. All right, I'll have to get into that next week. Got into the real Western mode. So we're going in a different world today, though. We're going to go in the medical marijuana thing. And WAIF-FM is a community radio station, serves only to open its airwaves to responsible, divergent points of view. The opinions expressed during the program do not reflect the views of WAIF, its staff, or its board of trustees. The opinions expressed reflect my views or ever any of my guests. The following program contains material that may be considered offensive or unsuitable to some listeners. If you are sensitive to such programming, please tune away at this time and tune back at 6 o'clock for Kitty's Blues. WAIF-FM does not endorse any candidate or group of candidates for public office. The opinions expressed during the program are the opinions of the speaker and do not reflect the views of WAIF, its staff, or its board of trustees. By the way, we are starting a membership member-thon here, and during the course, well, after the show, if you want to give me a call, I'll be here in the studio for a few minutes, and you can call in at 961-8900, or larrysbottomline.com is the website, just the way it sounds, no apostrophes. Feel free to email me, and I can send you a packet. Easy for you to send in your pledge to help us and WAIF stay on the air. Of course, it's the only station really in town that's truly public and membership-driven by the public. We can more or less almost say anything we want to here, within reason, of course, and within the standards of the FCC. But there's no other station in town like WAIF, really. And all the other public, so-called publicly supported stations are really backed by an alumni like, you know, the universities. So for true public radio, this is the last and only station in a town that really needs it, because you know the motto for Cincinnati, ladies and gentlemen, why stand still when you can go backwards? Anyway, that's part of what we're going to be talking about today, because we got somebody who's carrying the torch for medical marijuana. We'll get to Tanya here in a second. But again, I just want to mention that for $25 is our basic membership level. For that's $15, rather. I'm sorry. WAIF membership pin will give you. And we're going to give you these little gifts for you to help out, because saying thank you for giving us at the very least $15, which will give you the basic membership level. For $25, we'll give you the WAIF membership ambassador pin, the robotic slide world time calculator. They get new gifts in here every year, and I don't know where they get these things, but it's offbeat, weird, just like WAIF. $50, that's for $50. $75 level will give you the WAIF ball cap, which is black with red and white lettering. $100 will give you the golf umbrella, which is black and white. That's cool. $125 will give you your name or a loved one engraved on a plaque right here, on a brick, rather, at the WAIF studios. $500, if you could part with that, would give us everything. You give us $500, you can co-host the show with me, yours truly, Larry Arnett. Larry'sBottomLine.com is the website. Again, we're on twice a week, Time Warner Cable. We're on every Sunday at Time Warner Channel 24 at 4 p.m. and every Wednesday night, Time Warner Channel 4 at 9 p.m. So, let's get started with the show. We got a lot of people in the studio here, and Tanya is on. And why don't you tell us, Tanya Davis, got your name right, and you better get that mic. Don't be afraid of the mic, darling.
I'm sorry.
Okay.
Hey, Larry.
How you doing?
I'm fine. How are you?
Tanya, why don't you just go ahead and explain what it's all about, the whole effort that you're involved in right now, and you're going and tell us you're going all over Ohio, I don't know, all over the United States. I was out last week, so I'm not briefed as much as I should be. So why don't you go ahead and explain who you are, what you're doing, and what it's all about, and let the people know about this campaign.
Well, this campaign started because of the political season coming up. Everybody's trying to say they're all compassionate and there for the people. Well, I want them to put their money where their mouth is.
Okay, but you, in your case, you're basically trying to get the states to pass the proper legislation that would allow people to use marijuana legally for medicinal purposes. Is it medicinal purposes only, or?
Well, what I'm trying to do is remove a certain group out of the drug war. This drug war is a failure. We all know that.
Right. Well, and even let's face it. We all know that our government right now is pretty much dominated by the right-wing conservatives. And a lot of people have anguished over that for different reasons, obviously the war in Iraq and for other things. But at different levels, people have different disagreements with this kind of government. Yours, and believe me, I've lost loved ones, my mother to cancer. I know what the trauma is to go through a horrible, debilitating disease, not to mention just the chemotherapy alone is a nauseating experience. And for the government to not allow legally people to use marijuana, if that's what it is, that's what you're going after, really, is to just change people's minds about this so that we can pass the legislation?
I don't have to change people's minds. They already know it.
But the bottom line is, and of course that's the name of the show, but the bottom line really is, like I just said, and I'm going to have to play devil's advocate here. I'm in favor of what you're doing, but this is what you're up against, and nothing is going to change overnight. And I'll tell you something. I'm a baby boomer. I was born in the 50s. What's that?
Oh, this is what our government, this shows what level that they're at. This is a, did you know, Larry, that they send every 25 days?
Marijuana, cigarettes, hold on
yes.
a second.
Yes.
How do we get into this thing?
Excuse me, that came from a colleague of mine from Fort Lauderdale, Florida, that is a successful stockbroker.
Okay.
Honest to God.
Marijuana cigarettes, approximately 300 cigarettes. We don't have anything in here, by the way, so don't send it to the cops ever. I'm going to take it home and check this out to make sure it's proper. But seriously, okay, what is this again? Because we're,
okay.
I'll show this.
Our government sends 12 or sent 12 patients all over the United States 11 ounces of medical cannabis, U.S. grown at the University of Mississippi. Every 25 days, they send those folks 11 ounces of cannabis.
How much do they have to pay for it?
It's free.
It is?
Yes.
How do they get it then?
Gets mailed to their pharmacy.
But wait a minute. Is this under some legitimate program run by the government?
Yes.
Via the university? By the way, you can introduce yourself, Ken.
My name's Ken Locke.
Okay, you can bring that. I don't know if it's going to reach closer.
My name is Ken Locke.
Okay. And you're part of the campaign.
I'm here helping Tanya get this legislation pushed through.
And we're trying to push this. You're trying to push this through the state of Ohio. Is that correct?
It should be, yes, for her.
Actually, it should be national, but we're going to start with Ohio.
All right. Now, we know it's not. There's nothing on the ballot at this point statewide for this campaign, for this election coming up.
There is Senate Bill 74. There is. Ohio Patient Network are the writers of a Senate Bill 74
okay.
that Senator Jim Jordan is refusing to hold a hearing for.
So it's not going to be on the ballot?
No, not this new legislation. Okay, let's back up to that can.
Okay.
All right. Now, what appalls me is that there are seven patients still alive, that are getting medical cannabis
from the federal government.
From the University of Mississippi.
You can bring that closer, I think.
Now, what our government is telling us is that those folks, and God bless them for being able to use it.
Right.
But what
these people, it sounds like to me, there's a sanctioned program going on because there's a sanctioned program, believe it or not, via the United States government and through universities. I would assume university hospitals, where they're actually using ecstasy, the drug, because in terminal patients who obviously have a problem being able to get through day to day, just on the sheer depression of it all, ecstasy they find lifts these people's spirits. There actually is a contained test going on, so. I would assume that's what's happening with the marijuana. It's more like a test case, or is it?
Well, what happened was in the 80s, they had a program going that let like 12 patients receive or participate in this program.
Okay.
Okay. They had canceled the program. I'm sorry. Let me back up. I'm wrong.
Okay.
What they did was they had a whole bunch of applicants in the 80s trying to get it, AIDS patients
that signed up for the
program. The investigational new drug program. Bush's father, which was president at the time, because of the overwhelming response from AIDS patients.
People that signed up is incredible.
They grandfathered in 12 people.
That was it.
There are seven still alive, and they have been receiving over 11 ounces every 25 days. For the over 25 years.
300 pre-rolled marijuana cigarettes.
They get them pre-rolled?
Yes.
God. Yeah, think of it. I am getting a little...
And check out the date on that. It's 10-year-old weed. Now, they are not going...
They don't want you to call it weed, I think,
I'm
when you're
sorry.
Talking about this in the state
I'm
house.
Sorry. I'm sorry.
Governor, can
I
we just get this weed
that,
going?
But we're on the bottom line,
okay,
so I'm
right.
allowed to talk like this a
you're
little
right.
bit, okay?
You're right.
But what I'm trying to say is the medic... Well, actually, it is. The grown, they've heard that it isn't, so it's not even really medicinal
these people,
grade.
These people that are getting it. And again, where are they? Where are they located? Did you?
They're scattered across the United States.
Are they in? Are they in? They're in various hospitals. University? No, is this a university-sanctioned thing too?
No, it's these are basically people just like you okay. and me and us in this.
And
room.
At what state are these people? You said seven are still alive.
Yes, so, one of them is a successful stockbroker. My colleague that sent that to me is a successful stockbroker in Fort Lauderdale,
what was
Florida.
Wrong? And he was a participant?
He's got a condition very much like mine.
Which is what? Explain
pseudo-hypoparathyroidism. He's got pseudo-hypoparathyroidism.
And what are the... How does this manifest itself? What
it's
kind
a genetic disease.
Okay, you're in a wheelchair, so for the people that can't see Tanya, she's in a wheelchair. At what point did this start to affect you physically? Were you born? Is this something you're born with? And I'm only trying to get the whole details out to the people so they can
I'm
understand.
A domestic violence survivor.
Okay.
And I was beaten so badly that my spine has really got a lot of damage from
wow.
it.
Okay.
And I've got, from all the medicines from the genetic disease that I have, has tore my insides up. So I'm like really messed up inside. I've got gastrointestinal problems, and there's just a lot of pain.
Okay. But for the pain, I would assume you're still on some other kind of medication, legitimate pills.
I take 78 pills a day, and wow. when I can have cannabis, I truly can eliminate 30 of them.
Are you serious?
Yeah.
Okay.
Now, how can our government, this is why I started this role sure with Tanya.
How about, by the way, I'm just curious because, again, I remember when my mother was going through stages of cancer, for pain, they gave her Marinol. The pills?
That is
I know.
One component.
Right.
That's making a schedule one, taking a schedule one so-called non-useful marijuana, making it illegal, and then making their pharmaceutical derivative from a natural state and charging money for it, and it's calling it legal.
Okay. But you're saying, obviously, just let us smoke some marijuana. That's what helps. That's what, it's medicinal in its effect. And also, you would admit, it's not just it makes you feel good, mentally.
It works like medicine is supposed to.
And it's an interesting thing, too, is recreational people, when they smoke for recreation, you go for the buzz.
Right.
When you're a medical patient, when you're using it daily, that so-called buzz is not an everyday thing. You actually start understanding the medical properties of the plant and how it's helping you and your specific injury instead of the high. Because after you've smoked cannabis so long, you don't really get high anymore.
I don't know, though. If you take about five or six Vicodin, maybe have a beer or two, and throw some joints in there, you got yourself a party. I got news for you.
Well, this is my injury on my skull.
That's my studio audience. They're a little... Okay, we can take phone calls, too, if you want to call in 749-1444. Go ahead, you're on the air.
Hello, Mr. Arnett.
Hey, Blair, we're on a... Can you call back later?
Sure, my good
All right,
buddy.
Thanks. Go ahead. And by the way, during the course of the program, if you want to call in, you can do 749-1444 is the number. And again, you are listening to The Bottom Line. Larry Arnett here. And we got Tanya Davis and a whole crew of people here. I can't go through them. And we're also being filmed for a documentary, which will show up somewhere. Danielle is a nice-looking camera lady. We just don't have enough good-looking camera ladies. And you know, I've got my camera, but I have to run it. But anyway, so Tanya is here. She's had a debilitating... How would you characterize what you have, by the way? Is it, it's not a disease, you have an injury.
I also have a disease, crippling terminal disease.
And does that over time worsen?
Yeah.
Okay.
Very much so.
See, the problem is, here's the bottom line on what you're facing. And again, if you want to call in during the course of the program, we're talking medical marijuana. And
well, I'm challenging what I'm facing because I'm telling you right now, how can they say that this man's sickness is worse than mine? How can they say that his pain is less than mine or more than mine?
Because here's my point. Again, I'm a baby boomer, and I thought that by the time we became of age to run this country, and we've already had our first baby boomer president, Bill Clinton, And even Clinton, you would think, maybe would have been more open to pushing kind of, or being open to legislation. But it's not just Clinton. You got to have Congress behind all this. And by the way, our country, our government right now is run by a lot of conservative people.
But I've met a lot of those conservative people, and they've all told me that they do not believe that I should be in jail, that they would right. support and they want more information on medical cannabis.
But the point is, I mean, first of all, I would go like you're doing on a state level and try to get it state by state, because forget the Congress for now. I just think it's not doable yet.
All I want them to do.
Yeah, go ahead.
Right. I understand.
All I want them to do is take out the select group of folks that are under a doctor's care, that have qualifying conditions, and give us a fighting chance in a court of law.
And not,
I'm not legalizing anything.
That would also advance our medical understanding of that plant, too, because all we're doing is holding our own generation back by not allowing us to use these guinea right. pigs to understand this medicine, because the only way we've understood any medicine that's ever been is by our input to the doctors.
I mean, if I'm not mistaken, there is a medical use for people that have glaucoma, among other things, out in California. And Ray,
seizures here.
If what?
That section of my skull was removed November 13th, 2001. He's bringing in the tree limb to show you what was taken out of my head.
Right.
They had me on 500 milligram hydrocodone a day, 300 milligrams of Dilantin a day. I started out at 183 pounds when I was struck by that tree, and I went down to 124. I'm 6 foot one.
Right.
I took, after a year and 2 months on pharmaceuticals, I went through 2 grand mal seizures. If anybody's ever been through just one seizure, you understand you don't want to go through two, and you don't want to go through no more after that.
Right.
I was given no guarantee the pharmaceuticals would stop it, because they didn't stop it the first two times. So I said, look, this is my life. So I said, I would like to be a medical cannabis guinea pig, because I've read enough research and I've done my own little prey that I want to do this. So I dumped my pharmaceuticals in the toilet and took it upon myself. And I've been using cannabis daily now for 4 years. I've had no more seizures.
Okay.
This past summer, I rode a bicycle. And I haven't been on a bicycle in 28 years. But I set out to induce a seizure upon myself, do my own clinical research to find out whether or not cannabis was truly an anti-seizure medicine.
Mm-hmm.
So I rode a bicycle 3,200 miles plus this summer. Took me 82 days to go from the East Coast to the West Coast, and I had no seizure.
Okay. Yeah. So marijuana works?
Yes, sir.
And, you know, there's going to be people... There's going to be people out there that'll say, you know, anybody, let's face it, can get marijuana if they want. And while I agree that there should be legislation passed for people that need marijuana, if that's what it takes, that they should be able to use it without getting in trouble. There's no question about that. And I think
we're still productive, very productive people.
Right.
I mean, because we use a natural medicine to medicate ourselves.
There's nothing stopping you from getting pot if you want it, though.
No, there's not, because people do have compassion out there. They know it's too dangerous for us to grow our medicine, but people ain't going to watch us suffer when they darn well know it's working. They bring it to us, and they said, man, you keep on speaking out, because we all need this word to be given.
Right. And how does a state like, now obviously, I mean, this
North
is almost...
North Carolina?
Well,
I'm North Carolina.
Okay, but there's no... Is California, and you can bring that in... Is this what hit him?
Yes.
That's what fell 80 feet out of a top of a tree, and they estimate I took a 4,500-pound blow to my skull.
You can walk behind me so it gets in my shot. Or even put it behind me a little bit. Don't hit me with it. I don't want to, you know.
Problems.
I got enough problems with the, when I was younger. No, but, yeah, that is, so you got hit, and that went.
I fell 80 feet from a poplar tree when I was cutting it down. My wife was standing right there and saw the whole thing go down, so was a state trooper.
What is, California is more of an open state to trying things new. They do have medical marijuana.
California was the first state that stepped out and got Proposition 215 going. There was a lot of genuine people out there that wanted for the program to fully function. They followed all the state rules and everything to make it very beneficial for society and everything. Now the FDA and the federal government, along with the Bush administration, are out there right now in the past few months just beating the hell out of that state and jumping all over patients. We don't hear that on the East Coast because they keep it muffed up. Because if we the people knew what they were doing to our sick, I would hope to God us being a nation, one nation under God, we stand up and say enough is enough.
Well, how close are you? Because how long have you been involved in this campaign now, Tanya? I mean,
we just kicked off Roll with Tanya.
Okay.
As you can see, our shirts.
Okay, and you're going to be going where? Cincinnati to Columbus.
Yeah.
You can do that in an hour and a half.
Uh-huh. Now,
unless you're smoking pot, then it takes a little longer. You know you've had too much pot to smoke when you get to the light and you forget what the colors mean.
It's like, yeah.
What is yellow? All right, but seriously. So
get that's alcohol.
It could be worse. And that, you know, I think that's part of the problem, too, is that, you know, they feel these legislatures, you know, they get, first of all, I think a lot of the anti-marijuana, the anti, the mad mothers against drunk drivers, those people, I think, are more organized and more vocal. And they're the ones that are going to raise hell about doing anything that you're talking about. And again, I'm only playing devil's advocate because they're going to say, whoever brings up the alcohol thing, you know, there are more alcoholics and people have, you know, they're in hospitals and they die and they do all this from alcohol. And, you know, marijuana doesn't really affect you that way. Well, they're going to say, well, two wrongs don't make a right. And so you're going to have legalized, obviously.
That's fine, but you can go to statistics. And the statistics, national poll statistics shows that cigarettes are number one killer.
Right.
Alcohol's number two killer.
Right.
Obesity's number three. And they got a list of 20. Marijuana, cannabis, was at the bottom of that list with zero recorded deaths. But underneath a sub 8 article, there are allergic reactions. But with all the other statistics, massive deaths. Zero with cannabis.
My only fear, and go ahead, Tanya, but my only fear about all this is that, believe me, I've seen people, parents, relatives, I go through cancer and other things, and I'm in favor of it. I'm just saying that if by now, in 2006, after the baby boomer generation, who, let's face it, have a little bit more than a passing familiarity with marijuana, if they, once they get, and they've already been in power, they're in legislatures, they're in all over the country and in various states, and this is, thing has not caught fire, no pun intended, and except for California. So what I'm saying is...
Well, there's other states,
there's
too.
There's
12 states.
Well,
now.
Fill me in on the other ones, then. Wait a minute. Before you say this, you're telling me that the 12 states...
There are 12 independent states now that have said, listen, this is we the people.
Right.
And the way the Constitution is set up, that's the way it's set up. The folks of each state should be able to determine what is best for their people. And each state has seen that the federal government doesn't know what the hell they're talking about cannabis.
Okay.
They're covering it up. I mean, and when it comes right down to it, the people that are in power are the ones that hold the stock. They're the ones that run our government. They're the ones that tell us, we have us, which are non-synthetic beings, that we must take these synthetic products or we will prosecute you.
Why don't they just, you know... If it's a thing where big business, big pharmaceutical companies are in the pockets of politicians, which we know on the Medicare drug bill, there was a big windfall for the pharmaceutical companies because everything has to be driven through them, and they're getting royally rich or richer. So, why couldn't they produce the marijuana?
That's
and by
what
the
I'm
way,
thinking. I think the tobacco industry should pick up hemp and medical cannabis.
Right. It would seem like it would be. So what's the big hurdle now that this campaign is going to help overcome?
Well,
what they need to do is basically allow us patients to prove ourselves and give us that chance. Back in our past, women had to fight for their freedoms. They exercised the First Amendment. It was claimed that there was going to cause chaos if a woman had equal rights to a man. It didn't cause the chaos.
Right.
African American people also had to fight for their rights.
Right.
We are no different in a class of folks as they were. And now we are exercising our First Amendment and asking to redress a grievance.
How is Ohio, and by the way, during the course of the program, and we're talking to Tanya Davis, among others, here, and we're talking about the, how would you say it? I mean, you're trying to get legislation passed for the for individuals who need it to legally have the use of marijuana. And by the way, is there anything else besides pot? Is there anything besides marijuana and all this? Or this is specifically about marijuana, isn't it?
It's specifically to remove the sickest of our sick out of this drug war.
Right.
Quit making us have to go to shady places to find it.
A whole bureaucracy has been built. And again, during the course of the program, you can call in at 749-1444. I haven't been here in a couple of weeks. If you want to call in, again, we're talking to Tanya Davis, and it's the Roll with Tanya 2006.
Yeah.
So how far, how close are you to making something happen in regards to this in Ohio?
Well, I've got some good news.
Okay.
We have an Ohio doctor that just sent me a public statement that I'm going to read at the State House.
Okay.
In support of medical cannabis.
Okay.
I have written new legislation that would not be legalizing anything, but it would remove, it would give the judges and the policemen the opportunity to turn away and go away, or it'd give us a fighting chance in a court of law.
Okay.
It gives guidelines, and, you know, it really pisses me off that the government says it's okay for them, but it's not okay for us.
Have you ever got an answer on anybody that has anything to do with that particular program about why it can't be expanded?
Because it got shut down because of the overwhelming response to it.
It was shut down because there was a positive overwhelming response. Okay.
Did you know that Reuters just did a thing that marijuana slows down Alzheimer's?
Okay. Yeah, there. I mean, you know, there has been a lot of positive, you know, examples of the use of marijuana, but for some reason they're withholding passing any overall legislation on this. And again, I think it's just the conservative thing.
Well, this is why I am taking
money.
This to the people, Larry.
Okay.
And this is why I'm reaching out to Cincinnatians, Daytonians, Columbus.
What do you exactly want people to do? I would assume you want them to call their congressman or their state representative.
Absolutely, but they're not in right now. But
oh, that's right. They're campaigning. Go ahead. You're on the air.
Hi. My name is Rob Ryan, and I've been hearing you talk about conservatives. And this is not a conservative or liberal issue. I've met the number of liberals that are afraid to speak up on this issue as well as conservatives. So, you know, this labeling it a conservative issue is really not doing it.
I say this. This is my premise. You tell me if you think or you agree with me. I think in this government, I'm talking about the federal government now. There you can go state by state, I guess, and that's, I think their campaign should work state by state, obviously. But the federal government, I mean, you can't tell me that the religious right doesn't have carte blanche access to the highest levels of government, and then they don't have an effect on what is or what's not passed. That's what I'm saying.
Let's just stop for a minute. Let's bring it local here. You know who Phil Burris is, right?
Yeah.
Right.
What's his? Do you know the name of his? Just for everybody else, he's mainly his big campaign is against decency and
right
obscenity.
Now you would think, you know, here's a guy that, you know, the right a right wing conservative guy. When you ask him about medical marijuana, he doesn't think it's an issue. He wouldn't stand up and oppose it.
Well, in his case, he might think it would be, he doesn't want anything overshadowing his campaign. His campaign.
Yeah, as I say, you are talking about, you know, conservatives saying that this is, this whole issue is a conservative issue, and it isn't. It's a bipartisan issue. And the real question that you really should be asking, you know, whether it's medical marijuana or marijuana in general, is this. Is there a moral or ethical justification for the state to impose punishment on people using this substance? You know, and I asked that
exactly
of,
like Randy Brush.
I asked that of Congressman Chavez a couple of nights ago at one of these little forums. And he came back and said, yes, it's against the law. And they said, whoa, wait a minute. Let's step back. It was against the law to help slaves come free. Now, I'm going to ask you a question again. And the way I asked it was just slightly different. I said, is there any moral or ethical justification for the laws that put very sick people in jail for using marijuana? And he just looked at me like blank.
There's no justification for putting sick people in prison.
Yeah.
Well, I there are well-known conservatives who are in favor of doing away with the drug war. George Shultz, William F. Buckley, and just to name a few. But I just think that it's you got a tough road to go here as far as states like especially like Ohio.
Oh, it's incredible. On our bike trip, we went.
Well, you know, again, I'll throw out some local names. You know who Tom Brinkman is, right?
Yeah. He's the Democrat?
He's a Republican, conservative guy right there in your the woods.
Mount Lookout.
Lookout.
Okay, that's right.
He favors medical marijuana.
He does.
But we just got to get people dialoguing on this.
Thank you
very much for bringing this to the airwaves and having people like Tanya and Kenlock there. So I appreciate it. And
all right.
I think you discuss it more and people feel more comfortable with it.
Thank you,
all right,
Rob.
Thanks for calling in. All right, take care. 749-1444 if you want to call in. You are listening to The Bottom Line. Larry Arnett here. Every Thursday, 5 until 6 p.m., larrysbottomline.com, just the way it sounds, is the website. If you feel free to email. We do have a pledge drive. You can call me after the show if I'll be here for 961-8900 or larrysbottomline.com is the website. Feel free to email me there, and $15 on up all the way to $500. Whatever you can do to help support the station, it's really one of the last vestiges of free speech in Cincinnati, a town that surely needs it. And with me today is Tanya Davis. Ken is right next to her. She's rolling with Tanya all the way through the state of Ohio to try to convince the state legislature to pass some laws.
I've got the first event on the state house lawn of this kind. I got a permit for Monday the 23rd, and I'm really calling out. We want everyone there. We want the support to just be overwhelming.
Now, is this the 23rd of October?
Yes, coming Monday.
Okay, like you just said, everybody's out campaigning, so this is a thing to draw attention to it.
Exactly, and I want, you know, I meet with the governor candidates, the congressional candidates, the senators, and I have only had one person tell me that they disagree with me, and that's the truth.
Okay.
And what I'm thinking is it's time before the elections for us to put pressure on them and make them step up and do what they say.
Don't you just need one person to introduce a bill?
Actually, I'm wanting to have more than just one sponsor. I'm wanting to have a bunch of sponsors and a bunch of co-sponsors. I want it to be nonpartisan. I would love to have a Republican stand up and tell me that, yes, Tanya, we want to protect you. We want to not put you in jail. We want to protect Ken Locke or the Randy Brushes, you know?
In all 50 states, because we're supposed to be a democracy.
Right.
And, you know, there was no chaos from the girls getting their rights and everybody getting their rights.
How do you, maybe the one problem, too, is with getting, it's always tough for that first person to do something, especially if they think, you know, that might put their career in jeopardy. Whoever introduces this law, okay, well, you can read that or part of it. But, you know, whoever introduces the bill, let's say, to get the ball rolling, so to speak.
He's going to meet resistance like we have.
Well, I know that. I'm just saying he might be thinking, you know, I either have a career in politics and want to continue that career in politics, and this may come back to haunt me, especially in, again, I know our caller before didn't agree with me, but in the conservative climate that exists now, hopefully that'll dissipate, only because I think it's a barrier to passing needed legislation of all different kinds. They might be afraid that they're going to get caught up in some, this guy wants pot legalized.
No.
And it's always to fear mongering, which we know exists. They're going to make it sound like your kids are going to be smoking pot and have availability more so than now than ever, which is already available, whether it's legal or not. Everybody knows that they can get pot.
And there's a big difference, clarification that's got to be made too, is when medical cannabis becomes legal, that's going to bring around the industrial aspect. So maybe that's scaring the hell out of politicians,
sure,
too. But the thing is, when we made the bike ride across the United States this summer, a lot of people came out just to see for themselves a cannabis patient riding a bicycle. I've got to see this. So I had a man come out. He explicitly made it sure that I knew that he was an ultra-conservative. He put Bush in power. But he had seen and heard so much stuff. He had to come out for himself for 5 days with us through Kansas to see what it was all about.
Right.
He left us shaking our hands, and he said, I am supporting what you are doing.
Go ahead, you're on the air.
Larry, how's it going?
Hey, Ron, it's Ron the Republican. If there's a man who represents the Republican Party, it's this guy right here. How do you feel about this issue?
I sympathize with what they're doing, going through, but I don't think that legalization of marijuana is the answer.
Okay.
Even if you're under a doctor's supervision, Even if you've got the qualifying conditions, you'd rather make me a junkie?
I don't see you as being a junkie.
If I have to use morphine, then I'm going to become dependent, and then I'm going to be a bigger burden on you because I'm going to end up in a nursing home.
If I was still on my hydrocodone, which is a derivative of morphine, there's no time. I would not be alive today, and I think cannabis for the past 4 years.
Now, how do you know that?
Because I am on no pharmaceuticals, and I prayed on it, sir.
No, scientifically, how do you know that you would...
Scientifically, since the government doesn't want to do these clinical researches, us independent patients are having to do this investigating research ourselves, and we are being ignored with information that can better our medical standards in our country with natural medicines.
Yes, sir. We're just trying to improve our quality of life.
But the gentleman just stated that the... he would be dead if he continued to take his pharmaceuticals.
I'm 6'1". When I was struck by the tree, I was 183 pounds. After surgery and being on those pharmaceuticals for a year and 2 months, I went down to 124 pounds. I'm 6'1". 124 pounds makes you a fence rail. And I knew that I was dying. When you start dying, you know that, sir. And I dumped that stuff in the toilet, and I said, I'm going to put my faith in God's medicine, not in man's medicine, and I'm now here for 4 more years, and I thank God for that.
Ron, I mean, let's say somebody's going through the cancer, they've got cancer, they need to, and they're going to go through chemo, which I can assure you causes nausea. I've seen it.
I know.
Well, how many different things, you can talk about Marinol, from my understanding, it's not very effective, but I mean, why would you want to tell somebody who maybe in the last throes, hate using that phrase anymore after it was done by Dick Cheney, the last throes of such a dreadful disease, and if marijuana helps them, why can't you legalize it? What's the big problem?
Basically, you do have a legalized version of it with Marinol, and if there are other components that need...
It needs to be studied, sir. Please, open up a study. The Republicans to open up a study.
Why is it the pharmaceuticals can make Marinol from cannabis, which is a class one, so-called non-useful at all, no medical properties, but they themselves can turn around and use that plant to produce a Marinol pill, which is just taking a little bit of the true medicine of cannabis and saying, here, there's your marijuana if you want to take anything. And they cannot duplicate or replicate the medicine that works that God put into that plant. Man can't match that.
That's the truth. That's honestly the truth. And sir, I didn't mean no disrespect. I just get very passionate about this because my doctors all know that that the science is there. My doctors tell me that it's safe for me. How's come that there's 7 folks allowed to use it, but I'm not allowed? You know, this gentleman has lit up on the White House lawn, lit up a joint.
Who?
Irv Rosenfeld.
And I got news for you.
Believe it. Proud of that?
I've met another
patient.
Yes,
he has. He is not illegal, federal or state.
What's his name?
Irv Rosenfeld.
It's right there on the
page. I can say this because I'm Jewish, and I can tell Irv Rosenfeld's a Jew, and leave it to the Jews to always get the good stuff. You know what I'm saying, Ron? I'm telling you.
I think you want to talk to Ken about that one.
That's fine, but if we do some more research, sir, after my bike trip when I went out west, since we are so stifled for information on the East Coast, and the West Coast is so flourished with all this studying and research that's going on. When I went out there...
Why don't you get some legitimate scientists to try to get a grant that would allow...
Would you help us find those scientists and get that grant going?
Well, it seems like, you know, universities all over the place are always wanting research grants, and you're nobody until you're published.
What we need is folks like you that bring up that idea to help us get this going.
Yeah, push the Republican Party to allow it.
But I don't believe that.
The easier thing to do might be just to hang around with Irv Rosenfeld.
Evidently.
All right. A little levity never hurts anybody. But I would think, and this is the bottom line of the whole deal, and I've said this before, it's going to take state legislatures, it's going to take congressmen, it's going to take politicians all over the country to go through personally and watch a loved one, a friend, go through the horrible agony that goes along with these debilitating. Okay, can I talk? Diseases and other things like chemotherapy and other things before they realize it. And once you witness that, God forbid it's yourself that goes through it, I guarantee you, you'll be for anything that helps these people out, because I've seen it, I've witnessed it, and it's a horrible thing to go through. And for this country at this point in time to deny people marijuana or anything else that helps them through, it's a shame. And my biggest worry is that my generation, the baby boomers, that we're supposed to be very understanding, very open-minded when we were going through our teenage years, are now so closed-minded they won't allow it to happen. That's what bums me out.
Well, do you realize how hard we're working at trying to get the laws changed?
I understand it. I understand what kind of barrier you have, and I can't believe that the country... I understand why the country turned conservative, because I was around during the 60s, and this is all, and I know Ron probably agrees with me, it's all just it's a reflex action from the 60s, to be honest with you.
And another thing, too, laws, we have it, is, I don't know the exact way it's worded, but we have a moral responsibility to uphold laws.
Well, right.
But we have a responsibility to go against unmoral laws.
That's really, it's your duty sometimes to rebel. Well, you would agree with that, Ron. That was the way the country started, by the way.
Yes, under injustice of tyranny. But what I would like to ask your guest is, would they be willing to go to a pharmacy, if it's only for medical terms, and let's say they had a packaged product of marijuana. Would they be willing, under pharmaceutical law?
Okay, under pharmaceutical law, that would be fantastic. But as patients, we would like to know, as you do with your pharmaceuticals, is what is in that medicine. If they're going to grow if they're going to produce my pharmaceuticals for me, they give me all this information in confidence that this pill you're going to take, you got our best work into it. Well, we want the best of the cannabis, as they are trying to produce the
he
best.
He wants the good stuff.
Now, Ron, I'm on the other hand. Hey. I would be willing to go to the pharmacy and get whatever they gave me as far as cannabis goes, but I'd still be trying to research for more information.
How do you, but by the way, let's just say, because I think you guys, we could safely say that you've tried marijuana before. Okay.
No.
How does this stuff compare the lucky man, Irv Rosenfeld, who gets the good stuff?
What I was told, that's...
Is that one, and not that I've done it. Well, I've heard this thing called, like, one-hit stuff.
All right, yeah. Well,
people have told me, on good advice, that, you know, that's something, there's pot out there, you can get one or two hits in your butt.
If we're going to get quality, good medicine...
Is that the best? The government has the best?
No.
I always heard that. When you get stuff from the government, you know it's good.
Before you get satisfied, okay. Let's say if you smoke a cigarette, you don't get that final satisfaction until you've done 20, 25 puffs to finish that cigarette.
I don't know about that.
All right, well, people that smoke cigarettes know. All right, so with a marijuana cigarette, if you're smoking, do you want to do 15, 20 drags, which is almost a whole marijuana cigarette, to get to your medicated level? Or do you want a quality medicine where you only need to take one drag, which is less smoke and damage
right.
to your lungs?
That's right.
Well, here's my question for you.
Thought that out.
How are you going to ever propose with the FDA to get that approved as a approved method of...
The message to the FDA is start telling system. The truth themselves now. They're coming out with reports that it has still no medical
getting
use.
Getting hungry already. I'm just sniffing this thing.
The FDA...
I'm hungry over a Sunday, Ron.
Now, Larry, you see, I'm getting the vibe that...
The FDA needs to be honest with the American people.
What'd you say?
I'm getting kind of the...
vibe that they're doing this?
No, the gentleman. I think the lady seems a little bit more legit if she's willing to go to a pharmaceutical...
It's radio, so you can only go from the vibe of your voice and the way you're coming through on the radio. He thinks you're a pot freak. You just want to party.
Oh, man, he needs to look at my skull and the stick.
I'm telling you, I can tell you, I'm seeing
and
this.
And walking my shoes for the past 4 years.
Yeah, Ron.
Ron.
And we all have our crosses to bear. I mean,
well, they removed 4 hematomas from my skull. It's not just a dent in the head. They actually removed my skull plate.
I didn't say it was.
Before we go, so you're saying that if you were in a state legislature, you would not be in the affirmative section for passing any legislation that would approve such a law with approved medical marijuana use? Ron?
Me?
Under
which proposal?
Well, just any proposal. Just say a doctor, how do you call it?
Under a doctor's supervision.
Just like any other kind of medication?
Right.
That's fine with me.
Okay, there you go.
That'd be great with us.
Okay, thanks, Ron. Keep in touch, man.
Take care.
All right, see you. That's the kind of people. Well, see, I think under the right, it's all about the right, it's the way you put it, I guess.
Exactly. And what I'm really trying to do is I'm trying to give us a fighting chance in a court of law. I'm safe where I'm at. I'm not scared, Larry.
Right.
I'm retarded maybe, but I'm just not scared where I live.
How about when you go to like the state house and you're with Ken and he's been through a trauma. We know that. But I think there's something to be said about, you know, getting the numbers, the people.
I go to functions all the time. I go to Republican functions. I go to Democrat functions.
I just think that let me explain something first too, and this may not be a good or fair analogy because I think if politicians know that there are a great deal of voters out there that want something passed, yeah, they're going to listen to you if they know that there's something in numbers. Now, you can safely say we don't know what the number would be, but look at the effort by the gay community to pass, gay marriage. It's not been very successful. In fact, the right wingers or conservatives and others have turned out so vocally anti-gay marriage that's been unable to really pass on any kind of legitimate level. And my God, the efforts on both sides have been tremendous. The medical marijuana thing, and it may be more, you may have a better feel of it than I would because you're involved in it.
11 years.
I just say 11 years. Okay, I'm just... You go up to the state house, is it the 23rd?
Yes.
How many people you think are going to show up there? I mean, would you think hundreds?
Well, I think if the word gets out and people know how important it is, I'll be happy if 50 people show up.
But see, this is what I'm saying. And again, I'm just playing devil's advocate. I'm in your corner, really. But I just think that, you know, if they see 50 people at a rally...
They're going to think that's a good show. Yes, that's why I'm here. You make them come out.
Okay, well, this is a forum, and you're going to be on other radio, and you've got your forum, and you got to get the word out, and, you know, there's other ways to do it. It's direct mail. Cable access is a way to do it.
Oh, exactly. I understand. But I'm also going to be in Dayton tomorrow. I'm going to be at Courthouse Square, Main and 3rd, tomorrow from 11 till 1, then from 4 to 7 tomorrow evening. Free hot dogs and chips and drinks.
That's a good thing right there. You got to get people and you got to get food.
Well, we're going to be in Fairborn.
You got to get the voters out there through their stomachs.
We're going to be at Community Park East next to Fairborn High School.
Okay, this is all in Dayton.
Yeah, a little west. But we're going to be there from 4 to 7. Free food for anyone that stops by. We've got information to give them. The National Organization of Women just stepped up,
okay,
and passed a resolution in support of this medical cannabis with the drug war, removing folks from the drug war. It's awful.
Have you been in conversation with and have you talked to the people at Everything Normal, for instance? I mean, getting the people that they already have a platform and an organization and are pretty well structured.
We've got the vice president of North Ohio Normal sitting right here.
Okay, well, I didn't know that.
And he did not understand medical cannabis patients until he actually came and spent 2 weeks with me and Randy Brush.
By the way, is their whole attempt to get just marijuana made legal?
Basically, yes.
Okay.
He even saw me across the United States on the bicycle trip to see my effect and my success.
Okay, because again, I just think it's a numbers game. I mean, even you would admit, I mean, there is... There has been some success. I'm sorry. Why don't you give your name again?
Name is Jim Cowan.
Jim is with. He's a statewide Normal.
Yeah,
representative.
North Ohio Normal.
Okay. Now, I mean, you got to admit, pot, marijuana has only been decriminalized. It's never been. It's not legal anywhere, right?
In Alaska, currently, it's legal.
Alaska.
For
one. You got to go up there to be legal and smoke.
Canada.
I love it up there. It's beautiful, but
Washington.
It's not legal there.
State-wise, New Jersey just became the 12th state to pass legalization of medical use.
Go ahead. You can call back if you want. I didn't get that right away. 749-1444 if you want to call in. It's not legal there, though.
No, but they recognize medical rights. They recognize the medical defense. I'm sorry.
Well, wait a minute, though. But I'm just saying, the bottom line of the whole deal is anybody not under any kind of medically supervised authority, so to speak, like California does have it, right? Yes.
There are 12 states that allow
in
medical
Colorado.
Use
okay.
of medicine.
And by the way, if you're out, does that mean, and I don't know that you know, Does that mean, let's say, that somebody's under a doctor's supervision and under such a medical treatment in these 12 states, can they go to a park and smoke pot?
Excuse me, he can go and smoke it anywhere.
And get Irv Reisenfeld over here, for God's sakes. I want to hang...
When I was just for medical purposes only.
I thought for the show I could do some research.
He can light up anywhere.
What?
He's allowed to light up anywhere.
How can you tell me that a guy...
Federal or state law, he is not a criminal.
He can go to a...
Federal and state law, I am.
He can smoke anywhere. He can use his medicine anywhere. When I was in Miami...
What's his phone number, by the way? I just want to talk to him. I think it might be...
Well, when I was in Miami speaking, one of the other patients I got to meet, too, I got to go back on...
You're telling me, though. Seriously.
Yes. I just fired right up on stage with the Miami-Dade police standing right there, and they all looked at each other, and they couldn't do a darn thing because he is a federal patient.
Yes. Wow. He's not a criminal via federal or state law, but we are.
Okay, right. But there again, and your thing is not to be able to smoke in public, even though it might be a kick.
All I want is equal treatment and protection, and I don't even care about the equal treatment. I just want to be able to be in my home and have my doctor's permission and not have to worry about going to prison or jail.
And NORML has been around for how long as an organization?
Since 1974, I believe.
Okay, that's almost 30 years. 30 years, obviously. Ken, you've been saying you've been on this thing for 11 years. Tanya, I don't know how long, but do you feel like you're any closer to making this happen? I mean,
yes, I do.
Because we're here sitting right now talking with each other.
Well, right. We're talking about it.
That's a lot further.
And that's the key, and it's up to the people. And that's why we're reaching out to the people with the role with Tanya.
And under the way you see it, or the way it is in these...
Bottom line here, and nobody's got the guts to say it, but I'll say it.
Go ahead.
Nobody's got $800 million to lobby with like the pharmaceutical industry does. There's a lot of people in a lot of people's pockets.
Sure.
In our government.
And I think you just said it the way it is, and that is the bottom line. And you got that right. You got the money. You got to have the money. And when you have the money, and that's unfortunate. You know, and I've said this a million times on this show, and I'll say it again, and it's unfortunate because America is a great country. We can all say that. We all know it. We can do a lot of things here and have access to things that other people in other places don't. But our system is corrupt, and we know that. And maybe that's the way it's designed, but you do
no,
have
it's
to...
it's not the way it's designed because the founding...
It's the way it's been...
the founding fathers would roll
it's
in
the way
their
it's
graves.
Evolved.
It used to be illegal not to grow hemp.
If we go back in our American history, Massachusetts and Delaware, the farmers had land out there. Industrial hemp was a very important product to the early colonials because industrial hemp brought us out of the Stone Age. If we did not have that oil, we would not have town oil lamps. We would not have clothing.
But
would not have rope. The U.S. military would not have their hemp rope. For the ships and everything, if it wasn't for the hemp.
And but they just don't use that anymore. The money
nylon.
Thing is the key because...
That's because DuPont took it over with nylon.
The average person doesn't have the access to our government the way the big industry does because they've got the money. And he really put it the way it is. And unfortunately, that's the key. If there was... let's just put it this way. If the people that really smoked marijuana and smoked it mainly for recreational purposes, if they all banded together, if you could somehow band those people together and put their money where their mouth is, you could probably get together some kind of reasonable effort to put money in people's pockets and get them to try to pass the legislation. But they're not that motivated. They're stoned. All right, I just thought I got to keep it a little light here. But
Larry.
No, that is the key, though. You got to, and you know what I'm saying. I mean, we're not any closer. They've decriminalized it, and that's a good thing. Generally speaking, most people...
It was big money back in 1937 that made marijuana illegal.
Was that right?
Yes.
The plastic industry was afraid of hemp. It was the paper industry.
If you go back and do our history, you can go back to...
How about the alcohol? I would think they would have been against it.
Do our history, you can go back to the Hearst family, the Rockefellers, the Rothschilds. That was all a lot of timber and paper industries on the West Coast.
Right.
And they came up with the Marijuana Tax Act. And that was a lot of friends of Congress and legislature that got that going because they're in fear that their paper industry is going to be threatened with the new machine that was brought out for cannabis production.
Go ahead, you're on the air.
Hey, I just wanted to call, and you're absolutely right. Marijuana was made, or hemp was made, illegal for three reasons. It was a threat to the alcohol industry, it was a threat to the paper industry, and it was a reason to deport Mexicans.
Exactly.
And it's also, don't forget, too.
I never heard the Mexican thing.
But another thing that they hide very big about.
It was during the Depression?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
And the Mexicans were bringing over tequila.
Well, but
these guys knew how to party. I don't care what anybody says.
The United States government needed to create jobs or have jobs for U.S. citizens, so it was a really convenient way to get rid of people.
Yeah, exactly.
And if you look at all the congressional stuff that happened during that time, Randolph Hearst was against it because it was a threat to the paper industry,
yes,
because
sir.
Hemp was so much better.
And they had just come out with that new machine to break down the stocks so much faster to make
so
it
they grew,
production.
If they grew marijuana in any great number, they could have paper?
You
right.
can have clothes. I got my hemp shirts out in the...
a lot of your automobile.
Yeah. This is a big thing. We could put our farmers...
The paid for the movie Reefer Madness.
Oh, yes.
And it was a threat to everybody.
Well, they said that if you smoked marijuana, you'd go and kill and rape people.
yeah.
Right, exactly. I think everybody's...
If you look at the congressional testimony, it's bizarre, the things that they said. By the way, I just want to say real quickly, I am a Republican. I'm not a conservative. But I agree wholeheartedly, and I have a family member that could benefit greatly from the use of cannabis for her medical condition. Unfortunately, you know, she would be have an opportunity to lose her job because of it. So she has to deal with the pain.
And then, you know, you bring up real quick, he brings up a good point in the sense that, you know, anybody can probably go get marijuana and smoke and stuff like that. But frankly, if you did smoke it, even illegally, you could get caught up in a trap where if you were, let's say, had to go for a job or they sprung a little drug test on you in the
right.
course of your job, you literally could be fired.
But if you are
Absolutely.
Functioning yeah, your job...
Well, thanks for calling, man. I appreciate it.
Hey, you're welcome.
All right, take care. Keep
thanks,
in touch.
Thank you.
Yeah, go ahead. I'm sorry.
Sorry.
Go ahead.
Oh,
no,
go
he's
ahead.
Off.
No.
Go ahead.
All right. If you're able to function fully on a job and be totally productive in everything, and let's say you're not a cannabis patient, you're a... I don't know all the pills, but you're a...
Right.
A pill person that has to take them.
And they don't mind people getting addicted to hydrocodone or anything
yeah,
else.
Yeah, and you come into work and you do your job and everything, fine. You're not popping your pills in front of everybody. What is the difference to somebody medicating themselves where nobody has to smell it, where nobody has to see someone popping a pill, comes in, does their job at 100% quality, no reprimands. What is the problem?
All right. We only got a couple minutes left, so if you guys, I don't know how you want to wrap this up, but tell us again what to be looking for, and I guess what anybody could do if they're honestly, and I think what this last caller just mentioned is the key, and that's unfortunately people have to have a personal connection to somebody that might need this kind of thing for medical purposes. That's unfortunately, I think that's what it's going to take ultimately.
Well, if you would like to hear some powerful speakers, please join us. If you care anything about compassion,
yeah, okay.
It's from 11 o'clock till 2 o'clock in the afternoon on the High Street side of the lawn. Imagine that.
Okay, good. You know, I always thought that was an appropriate name
for Ohio State. It is the first.
I partied up there a long time ago. We weren't smoking pot or anything. We were just, turning cars over and all
it's
that
the
stuff.
First event of its kind on the State House lawn with their blessing. Please show up there. Show us your support.
And before we go, is there any, you want to give a website, phone number, because we're going to get going?
Yes, I want to say thank you, though, to the Happy Hamsters and Rob Ryan. They've really helped me here in Cincinnati. Thank you, Larry.
Okay, and Tanya Davis and...
MMJActionNetwork.com or FreeRandyBrush.com, and you'll find out why we're doing it all.
And if you want to hear live testimonies on the internet, go to www.j4j7.info and hear it from the people of America.
Thank you guys for coming in. Good luck on the campaign and keep in touch. And we'll
Thank
see
you.
You next week. Larry'sBottomLine.com's website. Keep in touch for Kitty's Blues coming up next.
And I hear that old name, a big stack of bills that gets bigger each day. The county's gonna haul my belongings away because I'm busted. To my brother to ask for a loan, 'cause I was busted.